So before we start, because it's Mother's Day and I wanted to take advantage of that as a mom with my boys, I asked them to help me out a little bit this morning. Now, listen, when I ask my boys to help, I'm very nervous because I never know what they're going to say. Usually they're inappropriate. So I'm hoping this morning in church that they will behave themselves. And then somehow Brock manages to take a piece of clothing off of his body. Hopefully he will not do that today. But anyway, so I have no idea what he's dressed.
Yeah.
Okay, right now. Yeah. I have no idea what they're going to do, but I'm going to let them have the platform.
Before they start, I want to tell a story about Michelle. Someone was asking her one time about motherhood, and she said, "I have the perfect son." And they said, "Really?" She said, "Yeah." They said, "Does he drink?" She said, "No, he doesn't drink." "Does he smoke?" "No, he doesn't smoke. He doesn't do anything bad. He gets, you know, he's just a really, really good." He said, "How old is he?" She said, "6 months."
Welcome back to Jeopardy, folks. Thank you for joining us. This is a special edition of our show celebrating mothers all around the world. The categories we've done so far, I'll catch you up to speed, are laundry, what did dad say, eat your vegetables, wine, and babies. Now we are in the last leg of our show with one more category to go, that category being moms. John, I believe it is your choice. Moms for 200, okay. This funny euphemism encourages life and death. Time's up. What is "I brought you into this world and I can take you out"? John, I believe it is still your choice.
Let's go Moms for 400.
Can we get you a mic maybe?
Thank you, producer.
There we go. That's better. You guys can hear him now. Moms for 400, what do I have here? This is the most expensive thing about being a mother. John.
What is trips to the hospital?
That is incorrect. Brock.
What is when your son wrecks your mom's car?
That is incorrect. Carol.
What is all the wine you can buy?
That is correct. That is correct. Carol, the board's yours.
Moms for 600.
Moms for 600. This phrase, "Mom, I'm hungry," is usually followed by what? Brock.
Tough.
That is incorrect. Carol.
What is "there's leftovers in the fridge"?
That's correct. Points for Carol.
Let's keep going down the line. Moms for 800.
800. Your mom requests to follow you on social media. What do you do? Austin.
What is decline?
That is incorrect. Brock.
What is delete my entire account?
That is also incorrect. I'm sorry. Carol, do you have anything?
I got nothing.
We were looking for follow her back. Follow her back. All right, this next question seems pretty simple. I think you guys can get this one. You have 5 missed calls from your mother. What is the right thing to do? Austin.
What is pray to God?
I'm sorry, that's not the answer we were looking for. Brock.
What is break my phone?
I'm sorry, Brock, that is also incorrect.
What is call her back?
Call her back. That is correct. Call her back, yes. All right, so I think that was all of our categories. It's now time for the final Jeopardy. Now, I believe I gave you each a sheet of piece of paper, so you will write your answer down, and I will give you the question now. Who is someone who loves you no matter what, who can take the place of all others, but whose place no one else can take. Go to Brock first. Brock, what did you write? Mommy. That is actually the correct answer. Brock got it right. Mac, what did you write? Mom, that is also the correct answer. Points for Mac. And Austin, Mom, that is correct. Thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen, and happy Mother's Day.
No. Thank you. Thanks, Steve. All right. Thanks, boys, guys, Austin, Mac. That was great. All right. Well, happy Mother's Day to everyone, all the moms. I love this day that we get to celebrate moms, or as I like to do, celebrate all women, whether you physically bore children or not. You're special, and you are to be celebrated today. So I celebrate you all. I always like to honor my mom, of course, on Mother's Day. So I lost her when I was 28 years old. She had just turned 50. She molded me, and she shaped me into the woman that you see in front of you today. I grew up watching her be a pastor's wife, and then later a missionary's wife. Neither jobs she really wanted to do, but she did willingly anyway. This kind of sounds...
Oh my.
Oh geez, okay. All right, so I was trying to think of a story to tell you about my mom, and I went looking through my cedar chest because I wanted to try to find a picture that I could share with you. Well, I came across this box with my name on it in my mom's writing that was given to me by my dad. I had looked through this box before, but not in detail. So here's the box. It has my name, Michelle K. Tanner. Anyone Full House fan? They got the name for me, Michelle Tanner. But anyway, I'm looking through this box, and my mom saved everything from the day that I was born, okay? She did that for all of us kids. Many of you have probably done the same thing, but I just have to show you some of these things. I'm wondering if it could be worth money because it's over 50 years old. This was her take-home bag from the hospital. This was the newspaper, the Flint Journal. I was born in Flint, Michigan, the day that I was born, October 11th, 1971. And then there's all kinds of her name tag from the hospital, the little thing that was on my crib showing my weight, the time, all this stuff, all in this bag. And then she has wrapping paper from some of the baby gifts that she got at her baby shower. Still in here. I also found something which I need to look a little bit closer, but I think this was in my baby book inside the page. So I don't know, I think I was 3 or 4. I swallowed a chicken bone and they had to take me to the emergency room. And she had taped to my baby book the wristband for, you know, the wrist from the hospital and the bone. Okay. And then, so then lastly, I found these sheets of paper, and they're just little drawings. And I thought, oh, that's sweet. You know, maybe I was drawing somewhere, and she kept all of them. No, guess what this is? This is from a game that they played at the baby shower. She kept all of these. So anyway, I'd like to think that I love that my mom saved all of these things. I'd like to think that she did it not only because I was her first, but also because of how much she loved me and she was proud of me. That's not to say those of us who save nothing love our children any less, but it just gives me a glimpse to my mom and what she liked to do, what was important to her. So this last year, I became a mother-in-law, okay? And I struggled a little bit, I'm just gonna be honest with you, Brent and Annie, when they were dating. It was hard trying to figure out my place and my role, you know, as they were dating. I wanted as much time with Brent as possible, knowing that I would lose him once he married, because that's what I was always told. When your son marries, then you lose a son or whatever. Well, I do have to say that I did lose Brent, but in a very good way, to a very amazing woman who I have come to love and appreciate dearly. I gained a daughter with Annie, and I come from a family with three younger brothers, and then I had two boys, so I didn't have girls, and then Annie came along, and I have to say, we laugh together, we go out together, we love to dance together, and we may or may not have sausaged someone's car the other night together with some other girls. Anyway, she is a... Yeah, I'll explain that later. Maybe it'll become a TikTok thing or something. but anyway, she is a wonderful addition to our family. And I thank God for her, and I thank God for my boys. And I hope that I can continue to just grow and be the mom that my boys need and a good mother-in-law to Annie. So instead of doing a message special today for Mother's Day, I decided to go ahead with Jeff's series and continue with the rules or laws for dummies. And this is the rule for today. Compare yourself to who you were yesterday, not to who someone else is today. A statement for me that is so much easier said than done. So here are some things that I just want to share and what I learned in reading about this and doing some research. No matter how good we are at something, there's going to be someone who can do it better. Many people define themselves as being a success or a complete failure. There's no in between. There's this idea that in this life, we play many games. And by games, I mean like roles or things that we do. We do things that go with our talents, that go with our giftings. If we don't succeed in one game, then we can try another. We each have gifts and abilities that are unique just to us. Deciding what we do with those gifts or how we use them is not always easy, but if we don't do one well, we are not failures. We can try another one to see how well we play at that game. Some of us like to say, and I know maybe there's a few in this room who are of the competitive nature, but they want to say, I want to win every game. I want to be a success at everything I do. I want to succeed in all. But if you're winning at everything, that means you're probably not trying anything new or anything difficult. Maybe you're winning, but you certainly are not growing and trying to improve yourself. When we look at everything we do, from our job to our family, to relationships, friendships, everything we do, every game we play, it is unique to you. So comparing it is just not appropriate. Each of our lives is different, complex, unique to us, and nowhere close to being perfect. So I found this quote and I loved it. It's kind of a long one, but it says this: stop comparing where you're at with where everyone else is. It does not move you farther ahead, improve your situation, or help you find peace. It just feeds your shame, fuels your feelings of inadequacy, and ultimately it just keeps you stuck. The reality is that there's no one correct path in life. Everyone has their unique journey. A path that's right for someone else will not necessarily be a path that's right for you. And that's okay. Your journey isn't right, wrong, good, or bad. It's just different. Your life isn't meant to look like anyone else's because you are not like anyone else. You're a person of your own, all with your unique set of goals, obstacles, dreams, and needs. So stop comparing and start living. No one can succeed at every single game they play, and no one is playing all the games that you are. And this is why the only person you can compare yourself to is the person that you were yesterday. So how do we do this? Because it's so easy to say, oh yeah, you know, but how? How can I keep myself from comparing myself to someone else? And ladies, I feel like for us as women, it's hard. I'm in the beauty industry, and oh my goodness, the ladies I work with, just all of that I see, the comparison, oh, I wish I had that, or that look, or that hair, or whatever it may be. We have so many things being thrown at us, from magazines, to TV, to social media, that make it hard for us not to compare ourselves to others. So I want to speak to the women for a few minutes. And Jeff, do you think that's going to be okay to go? Okay. Anyway, just a few minutes before I go to the how-to. Social media has many good things. Some of you have probably been able to keep from social media. Okay, good for you, that's great. I do enjoy social media. It keeps me in touch with my family, with my friends. However, there can be a lot of negative to it as well, and the way it affects us, especially the young girls of today. So if this video is ready, and if not, it's totally okay. I can talk about it or have you watch it. It's that second one, yeah. It's okay, yeah. I understand, yep.
And let's sit down and I will read you a book.
You are so beautiful to me.
Good job, Mary.
You are so beautiful.
Hello, we're Mary and Addie's comedy show.
To me, can't you see, dear Mary, everything I hope for, you're everything I need, you are so beautiful. Beautiful to me, can't you see? You're everything I hope for, everything I need. You are so beautiful to me.
our girls. Moms, if you have daughters, I just encourage you to check in with them about things like this, to talk about it. Ladies, let's check in with each other about it. I am so thankful that I have a couple group friend groups that I can go to when I'm struggling with anything, and that I can be vulnerable to them. Even when it comes to areas like jealousy, comparing myself to others, I can go to these ladies and say, listen, I'm struggling, will you help me? And they encourage me through it all. I loved that we had these young girls go with us on our retreat. I feel like the connections that we have made with these girls were so good. Ladies on the retreat, I hope that you agree with me. And I know that they have their moms too, but now they have us cheering them on as well, and that we can encourage them and help them, and they can do the same for us. I so appreciated in one of my friend groups, and we've been able to talk to you all and just to be real and honest with you and open, and I love that, and I think that we need that more in our lives, especially when it comes to women and social media. One other story I read also, and I feel like this is so typical, and I think of Lydia when I read it, because it tells this story about this mom who takes her girl to the pool, and she sets everything out, the towel, all the pool toys, and then she takes some selfies with her and her daughter, and then she goes on the pool lounge chair and sits while the little girl plays all by herself. And the little girl comes, mommy, mommy, can you come play with me? And the lady's on her phone, you know, just going away. So she didn't spend time with her daughter, but what was posted on social media? Those pictures. And then, you know, you think somebody's looking at that, someone like Lydia, who's home with two little ones trying to get this figured out, and then we're seeing something that's not even real life. It's just something that was, you know, posted. So let's just be careful with that, right? And help each other out about it. There's another quote I saw, Jeff. It's the "we're all a hot mess." I love this one. Oh, it didn't show up. That's okay. I don't even have it to where I can read it. Oh, can you read it? Okay, never mind. Okay, and then another quote said, "No matter how good someone's shoes look, they have dirty socks on," you know, something like that. All right, so let's go into how can we stop comparing. So here's a few things that I found in an article I was reading. John 13:34-35 says this, "A new commandment that I give to you, love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." So let me ask you this. Do you compare yourself to others? It's okay. Do you compare your faith to someone else? Do you compare your body with someone else's? How about your spouse or your children? Do you compare? You can fill in the blank with whatever answer that you want. Excuse me. As followers of Christ, we are called to give life with our words, actions, and attitudes. But how we carry out that mission will depend on the unique way we were each made by God to give life in our spheres of influence. So the first way to stop comparing, and these are very simple, like Jeff says all the time, right? This is not rocket science, but I feel like we need to be reminded and know some of these things. Number one, name your strengths. 1 Corinthians 12:4-7 says this, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." What gifts has God given you? Take time. I would encourage you, take time, sit down, write what some of your gifts are. Naming your strengths will stand as a reminder to you when you begin to compare yourself to someone else and that you're not a failure. Could you get me some water, please? Number two is know your weaknesses. 2 Corinthians 12, 9 through 10 says this, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" Thank you. We all have faults. Like I mentioned earlier, we can't be good at everything, unfortunately. We need to have room to grow. So take time to sit down and consider what are your weaknesses are, and then look at your strengths. Just because you have a weakness does not mean you're a failure. It just means you are human. I love this next sentence. We need to stop comparing our weaknesses to someone else's strengths. Because guess what? That someone else, they have a weakness. And it might even be your strength. So stop comparing our weaknesses to someone else's strength. Number three, and I thought this was interesting. I actually had never thought of doing this before. Determine your God-given mission. Take time, sit down, and write down a mission statement for your life specifically. We do this at our jobs. We have a mission statement for the church. But what about you specifically? What has God called you or asked you to do with your life, your words, your actions, your attitude? Knowing your purpose and your personal mission will help you when comparison starts to sneak in. As you stay on the path and mission that God has for you, you can be happy with the person whose skills you admire because you know he or she is excelling on the path that God has for them. Number four, as always, look to Jesus. Jesus keeps us humble when we look to all that he did for us. Without him, we can do nothing. When we set our eyes on him, we lift him up. When we keep him magnified in our hearts, comparison no longer has a place to breathe. I am so thankful for God that he is with me through it all. And that even if I mess up, and believe me, I have many times, he's right there to pick me back up again. Number five, act on your strengths and your mission. Don't waste time on being someone that you are not. I believe I have shared this before, but I remember as a young girl just being so frustrated with myself because I wasn't how I thought I should be. And it mainly had to do with being outgoing and talkative. I so wanted to be that person, and I wasn't. I was quiet, I was shy, and I just remember being so frustrated and praying that God would make me outgoing. But you know what? That's why I like this. Don't waste time on being someone you aren't, but focus on the things that God did give you and the qualities that he did give you. And it's funny because God has changed me throughout the years and I have become a little bit more outgoing, a little bit more talkative. Probably my husband wishes I was more quiet like I used to. I tend to speak my mind more now, but that's okay. But use the gifts and abilities that you have when it comes to your family, to your community, your job, even here at church. Seek to do what you do best with excellence. And number six, enjoy the journey. We are each on a journey. Mine is very different from yours. It is different from my boy's journey. It is different from Jeff's journey. As we are on this walk of life and live out our faith in Jesus, it is his strength that shines in through us. None of us have arrived yet. I know I haven't. But comparing yourself to others, it wastes valuable time in your mind. So when the comparison game starts, look back at your God-given mission. Thank him for the gifts that he has given you and choose to rejoice in your weakness. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says this, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, and he will surely do it." I just feel like we need to be reminded of this. And I think even men need to be reminded of it, because I know they tend to be of competitive nature as well. And so we all, these are just good reminders of us to compare ourselves to who we were yesterday, how far we've come along, not to anyone else, but according to our own journey and our own walk. In conclusion, and I'm not neglecting the men in any way, but I would just like this, if you don't mind, and I don't want anyone to feel uncomfortable, so if you don't want to, you don't have to, but I would just like all the women to stand up for me, if you don't mind. If you're near someone, maybe you want to grab their hand. Men, if your wife is standing next to you, your daughter, your whoever it might be, maybe you want to just put a hand on them. But I just want to say a prayer for our women today, if you don't mind, before I close. God, I thank you so much for the women in this church, the women who are standing here today. Lord, each one is on their journey. They've come a long way from where they were. They have a journey to go on, God. And I just pray for each one that you would bless them, God. I pray for the moms represented that you would continue to give them strength with each day. No matter if they have little ones, teenagers, adult children, whatever it may be, God, I just pray that you would continue as moms to give us wisdom and direction when it comes to our children. I pray for our young girls represented today, God. I just have a soft spot for them. I just can't imagine what it's like living in the world that they have to face today. And so God, I just pray for a special touch on them. God, that they would realize their worth in you and how you see them, and that they would just care less about how the world sees them, and that they would not be hard on themselves, but that they would just realize and know how much you love them, God. And you have great things in store for them. So I thank you for all these ladies. I pray for us, even though I know it happens with men as well, but as women, when we start to do these things, when we start to compare ourselves, God, that we would maybe put some of these practices together, that we would remember our strengths, that we would remember who you made us to be, God, and that we would act on that and not on anything else, and not look at ourselves as failures or anything else, but continually, day by day, minute by minute, see ourselves through your eyes, God. I just thank you for it. I thank you for each one here. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Now I know he's not well, but I had asked Brock to sing at the end of service, but he's just not feeling well. So on the back of your notes, I put a song. It really has nothing to, I didn't think had anything to do with my message. However, there are some things in there that I thought, maybe. But this is one of my favorite songs. One day, Brock is gonna sing it here on this platform for me. it's by one of my favorite singers, Corey Asbury. We sang Reckless Love today. He wrote that, and he wrote this song, and it's called Dear God. So what I would encourage you to do is just read it maybe, listen to it, pull it up on your music or whatever, and take a listen to it. But thank you all for listening to me today. And I just encourage you all, and that you would continue from here on out. And just don't forget this rule about do not compare yourself to anyone else, but compare yourself to who you were yesterday. All right, thanks ladies. Happy Mother's Day, and have a great day and a great week.
Mom, they don't call me.